you know of individuals who fit that very description. People whose lives were tragically cut way too short. Now, I want you to think as we begin this morning, according to the Bible, if that person has reached an accountable age, then right now as I'm talking to you, their soul is either in a place of paradise or torment. Is what we're talking about serious this morning? To me, it is the most serious of all the topics. Because what we're dealing with is the eternal destiny of our souls and the souls of our children and our grandchildren. And folks, let me tell you this. Right now, we are not getting the job done. I say that with all respect and with all humility. But the bottom line is we're not doing the one job that God has given us. You think about it for just a moment. He gives us our children for just a very short amount of time. Our job is to return those kids back to Him. And yet right now, the most current research shows it takes four adults just to get one faithful child into the next generation. That means you've got to have two sets of parents to get just one. In fact, 75% of all children raised in Christian homes who attend public schools will reject the Christian faith by their first semester in college. 75%. Folks, I don't think this community is immune to that. And don't get me wrong, you guys have got a great preacher, you've got great teachers, but the bottom line is there are probably people who should be here this morning, and you know they're not. In fact, there are probably people within a 5-mile radius of my voice right now who should be in this building, but they have already drifted back into the world. This morning, what I want us to do is I want us to look at seven reasons why we're losing our kids. And I'm going to ask you to do something for me. I know that all of us in this room have got things going on in life. I know you've got stresses, you've got things you're thinking about. For the next few minutes, I want you to put all of that aside. I want you to open up your hearts, your minds, and God's Word, and I want you to consider your soul and the soul of your children and grandchildren. And whether you are 13 or 113, I want you to think about where you are in relationship to God. The very first reason that I think we're losing so many of our kids is we don't know the book the way we used to. Lack of Bible knowledge. You know, we used to be called scripture-quoting, Bible-toting people, didn't we? They don't call us that much anymore. You know why? Because we don't tote it, and most times we can't quote it. The prophet Hosea, he put it this way. He said, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge." Now, don't get me wrong. I think in the church, we still do a pretty good job of teaching on things like the plan of salvation. And I think we even do, in most congregations, a pretty decent job of teaching on things like why we don't have authority for instrumental music. Now, I think that, we probably got that covered. But folks, I think when you get outside of some of those basic parameters, our kids are lost. In fact, I think we've raised one, probably two generations of young people who ultimately don't know why they believe what they believe. Take a look. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. The Bible says, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear." Notice what that verse isn't saying. That verse does not say, "Be ready to go to your preacher." Doesn't say that, does it? It's telling you and I that we must be ready. We've got to get our kids ready. Because otherwise, all they're doing is they are living an inherited faith. Ask yourself this morning, is the only reason your children are here because you forced them to be? Because moms and dads, listen to me. If you have not developed a knowledge of God's Word, what He has done for them, and a love for Jesus Christ in their heart, they will be the next statistic. And the reason I say that, they will eventually leave your home. I know for some of you that's going to be a day of rejoicing, right? They will eventually leave. And then they're going to get a call from the guys who are getting together on Wednesday night for pizza. And even though they know they ought to be in Bible study, man, that pizza sounds good. And they're going to go enjoy it. The next Sunday morning, when they should be here worshiping God, their Creator, oh no, they're at home in bed because they didn't set their alarm. Oh, they were able to stay up all night long for the Lord of the Rings trilogy. Yeah, they made that, but they're not going to be at worship that day. Or the next. Or the next. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, it says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Notice that first word says what? Study. So maybe somebody here in Richmond Hill can help me understand something I've struggled with. And that is, why is it in the church we give our kids a free pass when it comes to Bible study? And you guys know exactly what I'm talking about. We expect our kids to study algebra, don't we? We expect them to study science, and we want them to do really good on history or the ACT or the SAT. But when it comes to Bible, man, they get a free pass. Well, let me remind all of us, myself included, God is not nearly as concerned about an algebra grade as He is as to whether we have His precepts in their heart. Wake up, parents. This world is not our home. Because what I'm seeing as I travel all over the place, I see parents who have put secular success in the hearts and the minds of their kids right up here. Oh, yeah, I got to get a scholarship, and I got to go to that school, and I got to get that job, and I got to live in that neighborhood. Hey, by the way, where are your kids going to church? Well, there is that one little thing. That's not a little thing. That is the thing. Because as I travel, I'm seeing kids who quite literally, they don't know enough evidence about Christianity. They'll walk into a movie theater, and some goofy movie theater will talk about how Jesus was a fictional character, and they'll walk out with their faith shattered. They'll watch a television, quote, documentary talking about how the Bible is missing these gospels, and all of a sudden these seeds of doubt take root, and our kids grow up thinking, well, you know, I just don't know. And they become the next statistic. Reason number one is a lack of Bible knowledge. Number two is a lack of preparation for combat. Ask yourself this morning, if your child or your grandchild wanted to join the military, how many of us on the day they graduate from high school would put them on a plane and fly them to the front line of Afghanistan? Anybody in here be that foolish? No. Why? Because we want them to be properly trained. We want them to have the right equipment and the right training, and we want them to be able to adequately defend themselves, right? And yet, moms and dads, how many times do we pack their lunch, we pack their backpacks, we send them out into the culture war that is very real, and they're not ready? And folks, listen to me. If you think that just because you live in the South or you live in the Bible Belt that it's not happening, you need to wake up this morning. Because there are things all over Georgia, Tennessee, Alabama, Mississippi, Florida that are attacking our kids. You know, they go on a field trip where they learn that mammals are evolution's latest success. That they walk into a museum and they see those alleged missing links. Or maybe they just read their textbooks that is promoting humanism and atheism. Take a look at what Paul said. Ephesians chapter 6, starting in verse 13. Where he said, therefore take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. He says, stand therefore. Let me ask you, are we training our children to be able to actually stand? Because the last time I looked, what I'm seeing is a lot of kids who are blowing in the breeze of whatever direction society is pushing them. Society says to wear this. You know what our kids do? They wear it. Society says to watch this TV show. You know what our kids are doing? They're watching it. We've got to teach them to stand. As you're thinking about your own family, here's the analogy I really want to plant in your mind. If you think about your family in Christianity, are you on a cruise ship? And by that I mean this. I personally have never been on a cruise ship, okay? But I've been told that they've got like buffets for miles. They're pretty nice. And you can just imagine being out there, perfect 70 degree day, not a drop of humidity, kind of like out here. Yeah. You got your favorite Coke in one hand, your favorite magazine in the other hand. You don't have a care in the world. You're comfortable. Is that how we view Christianity? Because folks, listen to me. You better be on a battleship. Because Satan is real. And if you are mentally in that cruise ship mentality, if you think Christianity is all about being comfortable, you don't get it, and your kids, your grandkids will be the next casualties. They've got to be able to defend themselves. Reason number three is a lack of protection of their hearts and their minds. And I'm going to tell you right up front, I'm pretty passionate about this one. Jesus was asked the question, what is the greatest command? And I bet most of you in this room could probably recite it from memory. But before we look at it, let me point out something to you that some of you have never thought about. If there is a greatest command, which there is, by default, that means there's a greatest transgression. Remember he said, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. Now, had I stood by those back doors as everybody was coming in this morning, shook your hand and said, hey, do you love God with your heart and your soul? I think everybody in this room would say, absolutely. You know, you kind of look at me first like, who is this nutball? But yeah, you would. What if I took you the next step, though, and asked you, okay, what about your mind? Do you love God with all of your mind? And before you just nod your head nonchalantly at me and say, oh, yes, I love Him with my mind, we got to ask ourselves, okay, what are we putting into our minds? What are we allowing into the minds of our children and our grandchildren? Because, folks, we've already talked this weekend about the fact textbooks are filled with the ideals of evolution, with the idea that we evolved from some ape-like creature, that we came from not God, but rather a Big Bang. And don't kid yourselves. Don't think that it's just in science books. They're now planting these seeds in history books, in English books, in math books. I had a young lady in Alabama bring me her home economics book. First page, first chapter of a home ec book starts out talking about the evolution of man, folks. On a book on how to make biscuits. And yet, what are we doing? We're teaching them evolution. And again, moms and dads, don't think they're waiting for your kids to get old enough to defend themselves. They start literally in the very first grade. On the screen, you see a first grade science book. You open it up. It starts out by saying, the earth has changed much since its formation 4.5 billion years ago. And so already at age 6, your child is coming to grips with their existence on the planet through an evolutionary perspective. I told you guys yesterday, I'm the kind of preacher, you know, you all have been to major cities, you've seen the airports where the planes are kind of stacked up, waiting their turn. Usually about 7 o'clock at night, you see all the little bitty lights out there, they're just circling. That's not me, okay? I'm the kind of guy that likes to just land the plane, okay? In fact, I've been told that I've occasionally crash-landed the plane. But, you know, as long as you walk away, it's good, right? Let's land the plane. If we're honest with ourselves this morning, for 12 years, what we are doing is we are filling their minds with anti-God sentiment. Because folks, listen to me. God is not giving credit for creation. He's not giving credit for creating man from the dust of the ground. He's not feared and he's not revered. And yet Jesus said the greatest command is to love God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind. And yet, the tax on the mind don't stop there, do it? But what about our houses, folks? Well, what are we allowing into our minds within our own four walls? Let me talk to the dads for just a minute. Dads, I want you to imagine the following scenario, okay? It's Monday evening, about 6 o'clock, 6:30, you get off work, come home. You walk into your house and your wife has fixed your favorite meal, okay? Now, we're in Paula Deen country, so I'm sure it's low fat, right? And none of it's fried. We even fry our dessert. You walk in and you see everything there, and you notice your children are sitting very angelic on the couch right there. Now, I realize this is kind of Norman Rockwell, but just go with me for a minute. About the time you take your chair out, you notice that there's a repairman working on your refrigerator. Now, after the initial boop of how much that's going to cost you, you realize about every third word out of that man's mouth is a curse word. He is sitting there cursing up and down the refrigerator. And there's your children just listening to him. Dad, how long are you going to let that guy stay in your house cussing in front of your kids? And yet, Dad, let's be honest for a minute. How many times do we walk into the same house, our kids are sitting on the same couch, and they're listening to exactly the same words through a portal we call a television? And yet, you know what we do? We justify it. We call that entertainment. Well, again, Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind. Dad, there are going to be times you need to walk into that house, pick up the remote, and turn off the garbage. Because that is rubbish. Now, I'm going to tell you right up front, there are going to be some young people that do not like red hair very much after this lesson, okay? But young people, listen to me. If I get to look in your eyes in heaven, it's worth it to me. What about that computer? If your children have access to the internet behind closed bedroom doors, you need to rethink that. In fact, you need to put it in the most highly trafficked area of your house with a screen facing outward. You say, why would I do that? Because it's a whole lot harder to go to sites you shouldn't be on with somebody constantly walking behind you. It's a whole lot harder to have chats online that you shouldn't have. And you look at me with that sweet smile. You say, oh, but I trust my child. Okay, let's talk about that trusting child for just a moment. Like the 16-year-old at Cree Hall. Cree Hall Church of Christ in Nashville, Tennessee. At age 16, this young man had already been through the school of preaching. At age 16. He'd already memorized more Bible than most of us will our whole lives. And like all 16-year-olds, every day he checked two things. He checked his Facebook and he checked his email. And like most of us in this room, occasionally, he would get spam email. And he clicked on one time. Guess what? It took him to a porn site. This is a good kid. He clicked out of it. But that seed got planted right up here. 3 days later, he went back. And then he went back again and again and again. And behind the closed bedroom door of his house, with his parents in the house, this young man is now hooked on internet pornography. And you still look at me thinking, well, but that's not my child. Okay, well, maybe we can talk about the 7 preachers in the Church of Christ who contacted me in the last 365 days who admitted to having a porn addiction. That's just the preachers. You see, if statistics are right, in this room this morning, there's probably, if statistics are right, there's at least 8 people who are struggling with this problem. And yet Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind. What about their music? Moms and dads, do you know what your kids are listening to? You know, I have parents sometimes that will say, well, I can't understand what they're saying under all that boom, boom music. Well, guess what? Your kids know exactly what they're saying. And if it's not glorifying to God, you need to have the backbone to take that CD, snap it in half, and throw it in the garbage. Moms, dads, do you know that you can take the CD sleeve out of the case, read the lyrics? Or you can type the name of the song on Google and there's the lyrics. In fact, do you know that their iPod has a frequently played list? Through which right now at least one young person's thinking, I gotta be mom home. Had a lady that absolutely blew my mind one time. She came up to me after service. She said, wow, that was a powerful preacher sermon. That was a powerful sermon, preacher. She said, but you don't really expect us to break those CDs, do you? Those things cost like $20. I stood there literally thinking, what does it take? After I picked my jaw off the floor, I asked the woman one question. I said, what's your child's soul worth to you? Because folks, where I'm standing, $20 is a pretty small price to pay when you're talking about eternity. Last but not least, what about their friends? If you know your children are hanging out with people who are leading them away from heaven, do you have the backbone to step into that? Because folks, I promise you, in this room this morning, there's at least one set of older parents who are looking at that thinking, I wish I'd have done that with my kids. Because you see, Paul's words are still very relevant today. He said, do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. There's our first three reasons. Lack of Bible knowledge, lack of preparation for combat, lack of protection of their hearts and their minds. Number four is a lack of proper training in the Lord. There are a lot of people who believe the only time spiritual training needs to take place is within the four walls of a building just like this. And folks, if that is your attitude, you're failing. I don't know how many of you in this room know about the history of Bible class. Let me give it to you very quickly. Bible class is relatively new, about 100 years old. When it was first introduced, it was introduced for two groups of people, juvenile delinquents and orphans. And you know what the church did? They revolted. They said, do not do this. But the case was made that these people don't have proper parents to train up their kids. So they started Bible class for these people. And you know what Christians did? They kept their kids away. Until after just a few short years, then they started occasionally going and letting their kids join in. And all of a sudden, you know what they forgot about? They forgot about the orphans and the juvenile delinquents. And suddenly the church started training up the kids. And what the parents had been afraid of, what they were worried about, that the church would basically take the responsibility from the parents, and that the parents wouldn't do it anymore, guess what? That's happened, hasn't it? In fact, let me ask you this morning, do you consider the word Christian a noun or a verb? And by that I mean, is it a label that you wear, or is it a lifestyle you live? Because if it's a label that you're wearing Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, your kids can see right through that. It's got to be a life you live. Take a look with me, Deuteronomy chapter 4. I want to make sure everybody in this room understands I'm not letting anybody off the hook. Deuteronomy chapter 4. Look with me in verse 9. Only take heed to yourself. Diligently keep yourself, lest you forget the things your eyes have seen, lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life. Notice the last phrase. Teach them to your children and your grandchildren. Wait. You mean once my child leaves the home, I still have a responsibility? Folks, as long as your child has a breath in their lungs, you still have a responsibility. Take a look, Deuteronomy chapter 6. Probably one of the best known of all the verses. Verse 4 is actually called the Shema, the call. It's not on the screen. It says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. It's the very first verse. Because it then gives a whole list of instructions. It gives all of these things to do to youth ministers. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Now, it's actually talking to school teachers. No, it's talking to daycare center workers, right? No, it's talking to parents. And it tells parents, you shall teach them diligently. In fact, he gives a prescription. He says, you want faithful kids? All you got to do is teach your children four different times about God. When you lay down, when you wake up, when you're sitting, when you're walking. That's all you got to do. You'll know the sad part? In many homes, we don't talk about God at all. Oh, we talk about football. And we talk about the Olympics. And we talk about all kinds of things. But when it comes to the most important matter in the universe, their eternal destiny, we remain silent. In fact, we have forgotten that our soul job is a soul job. So ask yourself, in all sincerity this morning, is Bible class in this building the only source of biblical instruction your kids are getting? Because folks, Bible class should be great. It should be the icing on the cake, so to speak. Reason number five is a lack of proper teaching. Now you look at me and you say, come on, Brad. You know, as long as we're teaching our kids about God, isn't that enough? And I'm not sure why my computer just did that, but let's see if we can catch it up. Right now, I mentioned this yesterday, there is a push in society to basically paint God as a God of only love and grace. Kind of that grandfatherly-like figure who never get on to anybody. Now, folks, think with me for just a moment. If your child grows up thinking that God is only a God of love and grace, is he going to be as determined to walk in the light? No. He's going to live the life he wants to live, thinking everything's good. I'm covered. Love and grace. Not realizing that sin separates us from God. Now, I'm firmly convinced that we're no longer painting out a full portrait of who he is. In fact, I believe my generation basically completely abandoned a healthy fear of the Lord. Take a look, Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 12. Now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you but to fear your God? Psalm 111, verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Are we really supposed to fear God? Let me tell you a story about developing a healthy amount of fear. I talked back to my dad one time when I was little. My dad's 6'4". He's a big man. I was about 8 or 9 years old. We were sitting at the dining room table. My two brothers were sitting over here at my left. We were having a really good conversation. Don't remember what it was, but I remember it was really good. And I had just taken a bag of mashed potatoes when I heard my dad over here on my right say, hey, Brad, can you please pass the mashed potatoes? At which point I kind of cocked my head. I said, you can wait. And I went back to talking to my brothers. Oops. At which point those potatoes came flying out of my mouth, involuntarily, and my cheeks started to burn a little bit. Now I realize some of you in this room may think, man, that's abusive, but let me tell you what. Number one, no, it wasn't. Number two, it has helped me understand something about the pattern that God put forth. It helped me to develop a healthy relationship with my earthly father that I can now translate into my heavenly father. You see, part of the problem we got in the church, we're raising kids that do not fear or respect their parents. How do we expect them to have the right relationship with God? What I'm trying so desperately to get you to understand this morning is it's like a chain. And you are the first link of that chain. And your children are the next link. And your grandchildren are the next link. And what you've got to do is you've got to get that whole chain to heaven. And it's multi-generational faithfulness. And yet, if we're honest with ourselves this morning, there's some links this morning that need some titanium put on. They're weak. Reason number six is a lack of proper priorities. Moms and dads, our kids know how we spend our time and our money, don't they? My wife and I have a saying that we say quite often, and I'm sure you've either heard it or said it yourself, and that is, people do what they want to do. And by that I mean, if you want to go to a movie, you go to a movie. If you want to do something else, you'll do something else.